Good afternoon. Is the mic on? Yeah. Hey, and welcome to this session VCL307 on Advanced Configuration Manager R2 Infrastructure. My name is Kent. I don't know how many of you actually attended the first session I had just before lunch. Yeah, the name is still the same. Live in Copenhagen in Denmark. Have been working with SCCM and SMS since 96. Back then it was called SMS 1.2. Been working with CM12 for 3 or 4 years by now. And I've done a lot of projects, written a few books and stuff like that. I have some questions before I start the session, and your answer will actually determine what slides I'm going to show and if I'm going to show any slides and so on. So how many of you are running CM12 today in production? It's like a third of you. How many of you are running CM07? Oh, that's like half of you. That's pretty good. How many of you are not running CM at all? Cool. Are you going to? Otherwise, it's really nice seeing you guys. I mean, I'm not going to throw you out or anything. It's pretty cool. Okay, so I might change the agenda a little bit. I hope it's okay, so I will also turn it over to kind of a best practice thing, stuff you have to look out after once you have done your migration or if you're planning to do a migration. Because what I've seen is that the trend is kind of when you migrate from CM07, you're still in the same mindset. So you still kind of design your collections and your infrastructure like in CM07, and we really don't want to do that. I really love questions, and don't wait for me to stop, because that won't happen until like 58 minutes from now. So just shout them out if you feel like it. And I do have a few books with me and some speakers, and I'm not bringing them back to Denmark, so good questions will absolutely be rewarded. So we're going to talk a little about SQL, and if you haven't migrated yet, this is very important. If you have already done your migration, this is still pretty important, and hopefully I will show you some stuff you can go home back Monday morning and kind of customize in your own environment. Then I have a few things about the site system roles, but that really depends on how many users you're supporting in your environment. I do not believe that many of you are supporting more than 100,000 users, given that New Zealand is approximately the same size as Denmark. We are 5 million and you're 4.5, very, very close. So we are very similar when it comes to the size. So, and then at the end, a little about work group and forest support. So first off, SQL Server consideration. This is an advanced session, but I mean, keeping it simple is my most important message at all. I've been involved in many projects where we have a SQL DBA and they know a lot of stuff, but seriously, please don't touch my database because I want to be the one that managed the database. I want to be the one that has full access to the database because I have to go in there from time to time and maybe do a query or stuff like that. We're not allowed to modify anything in the database and I'm not doing that. So if I can have it locally, that's absolutely okay. And I know that the DBA guys, they will say, okay, but if you do it locally, it will have an impact on performance. I go, no, not really, because we will size our hardware after the fact that we actually have SQL installed. And we will also offload the SQL load instead of offloading SQL, because if you offload SQL, you're actually not offloading the SQL load, you're just moving the SQL load to another box. So I'm going to offload it to another machine, but still have SQL locally. For the SQL Server version, all of us running a single primary site, we should just stick with a standard edition. It's part of your license. There's really no reason why you go in and install an enterprise. Most likely, you'll be more than happy with a SQL standard. And you can install that SQL standard edition on as many servers as you want to, as long as it's used for config manager, meaning if you want to offload your database to an management point replica, it's quite all right to actually install SQL there. So don't worry about the license cost for that one. The estimated database size, my experience is that it's about 5 megabytes per client, but I've seen any sizes between 3 megabytes and like 12, 13 megabytes. And it's really about planning what you want to get out of Config Manager. Don't just go in and enable everything because you can. It's often a bad idea. Some other SQL Server considerations. we want to have it local. Okay, but we want to make sure that we don't just do a standard SQL install. And it's quite all right that we are not SQL experts just because we're SCCM experts. But having a few guidelines, like the number of database files. By rule of thumb, you should have a database file per core, but you should not have more than 8 database files. What we have seen is that after, if you add a database file number 9 and 10 and so on, it actually doesn't have a positive impact on performance, more likely a negative impact. So most of us in here will do fine with something like 4, 6, or 8 database files. Now, can you add that after you have installed SQL? Those of you who are still running, who have already done the install, you can do that, but the performance impact might not be as good as if you did it from the beginning. So all of you who are running CMO 7 today, you will go back home when you install your CM 12, pre-create the database, and be in complete control of your database files. I'll show you how you can do that. Some very important things in here is the autogrowth. I have seen a customer. There are about 2,000 seats, not a huge site, but a typical Scandinavian site. And their log file, they're running out of disk space on their log drive because their reporting server log files were 55 gigabytes. I'm like, wow. And the thing is, when you install the reporting server, the default settings, you really want to go in and make sure you change them. First of all, you want to make sure that you change the autogrowth. You don't want to run out of disk space on your log drive, because if that happens, everything kind of just shuts down. So make sure you control that. I will demonstrate that in a few seconds. And also make sure you cap your limit your log files. I mean, there is really no reason why it should be allowed to grow to 2 petabytes or something like that. Go in and figure out 20 gigabytes is enough for you, then just configure it to 20. And make sure that your recovery mode is configured to simple, because by default it will be full, meaning that it does not empty the log file until you actually do a backup. And how many of you in here are doing a backup of your reporting server? 1? 2? So the rest of you, you could actually experience what I just told you, because if you're not doing a backup, chances that you have gone in and actually reconfigured your reporting server, your recovery options are not that high. So it takes like 5 minutes to do this, and it really can save your day. The customer that I went to, it saved my day because it took me a day and I was paid by the hour. So that was pretty okay. But there's really no reason for that. The disk layout, an example of that. Now, I know that some of you have it on a SAN and you might not have to worry about your disk, but it's all about IOPS. The more, the merrier. This is kind of my traditional disk layout that I would recommend. For me, the most important thing is that we split the database and we split the log files. We have the tempdb on a separate drive as well. And of course the operating system on a separate drive. And since we all have a primary site server, you also need to calculate disk space for your content library, even though you might offload your distribution point, because the content library will still be on your primary site server. Do I do this if I go into a customer where there are only 500 seats? Yeah, I still do that. I still do it because I can control my SQL pretty easy by having an INI file, and I would usually install SQL using an INI file because that makes it easier for me to control everything. So let's just have a quick demo here. So what I have is I have a 2012 R2 preview, and let's just imagine that I haven't installed anything yet. So what I want to figure out is how I should actually install and configure my SQL database. I will do that by going into Excel. I created this. This is what I can do in Excel, different colors. Awesome. It took me a half a day. So what I have in here is basically kind of a rule of thumb. So if I go into a customer and they say, okay, we have 4,500 clients, and I will estimate that they're using like 5 megabytes per client, then I know the number of processors, and I know the number of cores and the memory that they have, because they are going to explain that to me. So what I see over here is, how should I actually configure my database files? So instead of having 12 files, I might change that to 4, because that will give me the performance that I'm looking for. And then I can see the size profile, the auto growth, and I can see that for my log files, my TimDB, and so on and so forth. So this is like the first thing I do. I can also see the memory configuration. The second thing I do is I get this script. This script here is a script used internally by Microsoft and published by Microsoft. And what I have to do in here is I basically just have to go in here and say my site code will be NSET1. So it will create a database with that. And then after that, I will go down here and say, so I will create 4 files. Each of the files will be, and then I can specify the size. And that's it. So I'll just go ahead after this and run the script. When I run the script by default, it will be in testing mode. So you can see here, 0, the bit means testing. And if I want to go in and create the database, I need to change that to 1. And then execute that. So when I go ahead and install my configuration manager site server now and say, okay, my site code is going to be NSET1, it will automatically detect that the database is already created, and then it will use that database. So that's one way of achieving what I call complete control from the beginning. That's a good question, but there is no swag for you, James. So the question is, if you let SCCM or Config Manager go ahead and install the database, it will create a single database file, and that database file will be 1.12 gigabytes. It's not a huge issue if you ask me, if you're like a small size, but if you're an enterprise size or you might be a medium size, you really want to control that. So it's all about performance. That's my, yeah.
Ken, is it easy enough to change the location of the content once you've installed it? Or we've gone and done the installation, haven't split the content off. Is it easy enough to move that after install, or do you have to start again?
So the question is if it's easy enough to move the database files and the log files?
No, more your content
library. My content library. Oh, that was a pretty good question here. So the content library, is that easy to move? Yeah. It's easy to move because in Service Pack 1, the toolkit to Service Pack 1, we actually have a content library tool that we can use. I've used that once myself in production because I had to. And I don't recall exactly, but it took something like half an hour, maybe an hour. But basically, it's very easy. Just run the tool, say, this is where I have my content library. This is where I want to place it. And then it will just go ahead and run that. Yeah. Okay, now I have my database created. The next thing I would do in here is I would go into my database because I created it using a script. I would go into the properties, my options in here, and then I will change the recovery model from full to simple. Again, because I do not need my log files when I do a restore. If I have to do a restore of my environment, the latest backup is good enough for me, I don't really care if I lost a package or if I lost some inventory data, they will come back into the database. when I look at the files in here, then you can see I have four files, 3.5 gig in size. And what I would do, and what you should go back home and do on Monday, is you should definitely go into your log files in here, and then instead of having them limited to this, go in and figure out what do you have. Maybe 20 gigabytes is enough, something like that. Also change your autogrowth. So if it's by default 2%, SQL is actually using quite a bit of performance when it's enlarging the database and the log files. And seriously, you don't need that. So just set the autogrowth to a higher value. And when you have specified your database file size, really, it should actually never auto. It should never enlarge the database because you already have estimated the database size. So I would do the same for my report server. Go in, cap the log files and stuff like that, and then on your SQL box, those of you who have already done the install, you know that you will get a warning if you don't go in and configure the minimum memory. So that should be at least 8 gigabytes. And then the maximum memory. And the maximum memory for me is the maximum amount of memory I have minus 2 gigabytes for the operating system, minus 2 gigabytes for a config manager. And then if you have anything else running, so typically I would take 4 gigabytes from my total amount and then give that to SQL. Yeah. From here, I'm almost done with my work in SQL. There is a few more things that I tend to do, and one of them is setting up my backup. How many of you are using the Config Manager backup today? All of you who are running CMO 7, you have to raise your hand because that's the only supported backup method in CMO 7. How many of you are running SQL backup in CM 12? 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so the benefits of running the SQL backup in CM12, I can easily illustrate that because what I've done here is, this is my plain configuration manager backup. Okay, so I just went into my task, site maintenance task, enabled the backup, and you can see here my backup size is 7 gigabytes. If I look at my SQL backup, then the very same, and it's not even the same, but that's 2.3 gigabyte. So with SQL, what I do get in advance is I get compression. It doesn't shut down any of my configuration manager services, and I can also configure a backup of the other databases. So in this folder here, I actually have a backup of my reporting database, so I do take a backup of that, even though I might not even restore it, I might just reinstall if something goes wrong, but still, and can also take a backup of my MDT database and stuff like that. And we don't have to be SQL experts to do this. I just created a maintenance job in here, and there is a maintenance plan wizard where you can go in and go through that and say, okay, I want to do a backup, and it will ask you about the databases that you want to include, and do you want to compress those, and do you want to store them in the same folder, and so on. And that's kind of about that. One more thing I do in my SQL is, and let me just go into Configuration Manager in here. If I go to my site and go to my site maintenance task, and go down to this one here. Rebuild indexes. Hopefully you have this enabled, because rebuilding the indexes in a database is very crucial for performance. The thing is, from time to time, it seems like this actually doesn't work in CM12. I've been to customers, one customer where it took when I went into the monitoring node here, and I went looked at my deployments, and just took a quick look at the deployment status and tried to open up the deployment status, it took 8 minutes to open up this one here. And we were like, man, that's a long time, especially because we were still in a pilot. The pilot was 1,000 users, but still. So it turned out that it was actually the indexing job that never really, really started. I had another customer where when they imported a computer into Config Manager, it never refreshed their collections. You know, it's just showing the hourglasses, and we were like, what's going on here? Then I went to a session, a Microsoft-hosted session, and they said, well, you know, internally, we're running this defrag script here, rebuild indexing script from a guy from Sweden called Ola Hallengren. I was like, okay, I really need to take a look at this one here. So the thing is, this script, what this will do, and it's fully documented, when you run the script, it will create the needed stored procedures and so on to support your solution. Once you have run that, and I've already done that, I did that kind of just before we started the session, so you can see commands have started successfully. Then I will run this script here once a week. This will rebuild my indexes, figure out if my tables are fragmented, and then do the defrag and all of that stuff. And it's doing a pretty good job at it. We ran it at the first customer, the 8 minutes. It took 16 minutes to rebuild the indexes. After that, it took less than 3 seconds to go in and have a look at my deployment in the monitoring node. The other customer, where the collections never really seemed to refresh, I was on a conf call with them, and I said, okay, let's set it up, let's run it. It might take, give and take, maybe 16, 30 minutes. After an hour, we agreed that, because I was running out of jokes there, we agreed that, okay, maybe you can call me back. And he called me back the day after. It took 16 hours to run the indexing job there. I was like, ooh. But after that, he could actually import computers. We had to go in and do some stuff with his collections because he really messed up his collection design. But that's about all the stuff that I do in SQL. Once I've set this up, I mean, everything seems to be running okay. So control the database size, go in and manage the files and stuff like that, cap the limit in there, and then set up the indexing. And the indexing in here, you can set it up as a SQL job. Would I do this on other databases? Absolutely, because this is not a configuration manager solution. Would I do it in my CMO7 database? Absolutely. So I see no reason not why to. Yeah?
With the site system maintenance app, the site system backup app, is there actually any reason to do that in CM12, considering all you really need is the database to proceed?
See, that's a pretty good question. So the question is, let me just, here you go, sir. So the question is, do we really need the configuration manager database site maintenance task enabled? Because we only use SQL when we're doing a restore. And the answer to that is no. So why do we still have it? Because it's very easy. You can control your backup without having to go into SQL. So you don't have to call your SQL DBAs and say, hey, please. But often, if your database is hosted by a DBA team, they have already taken care of your backup. That's often not an issue. Let's see if I can switch this one here. So, speaking of site systems, this is what I get when I go into a project. People are like, oh, my boss says we need to have high availability, we need to be able to operate 24/7 and all of that. And I'm like, wow, so why? Yeah, if a site goes down, we need to be able to, if a site goes down, don't you think you're more worried about your mail and some of the other things? And normally, Configuration Manager is categorized as a system that we can live without for 24 hours. So I need to design my site for max uptime. It's something. Sometimes people are saying, okay, we need to have multiple sites. It will just add, additional licenses. It will just be a much more complex environment. It's really not, yeah, question?
Sorry, about the batching on
So you have multiple primary sites or secondary sites?
Okay. So
is it recommended to back up the secondary sites as well? You don't really have to do that, but what we can do is we can actually now restore a secondary site. And I know I just told you you don't have to back it up, but that's because the only thing we kind of restore is actually the content. We don't worry too much about the database because it's just a subset of your global data. So we really worry about your 250 gigabytes of packages that you have out there. And those, when you restore your secondary site, those you can actually restore. So if you have your content on another drive or something like that, then it can actually restore that. But it will perform a new installation when you go through the restore wizard. So the answer is no. No. Okay, what else do we see? When we talk to the SQL DBAs, they will say stuff like, SQL 2012 has a new feature called Always On, and it really rocks, and it does, and it's not supported. So let's move on. I need to cluster my SQL. And I'm like, seriously? Why? And then I know why you want to cluster SQL, and it works, but it just, again, makes it much more complex. And for me as a consultant, hey, two extra days, no worries. But for the customer, it's unnecessary. Often it's unnecessary. And then I need to mirror my SQL. Mirroring SQL is, again, not supported, but the danger of doing that is that it actually works right until the point where you go in and do an upgrade. Because when you do an alter database, and you've seen that, I've seen that as well, this is what is going to happen. So you everything is good. You have tested your DB upgrade, everything is good. But when you perform the actual upgrade, boom, it breaks. Alter database, and you won't be able to restore. It won't roll back, so you have to restore from that point. So all the fancy stuff, hopefully it will be supported one day, but right now it's not. And that's end of discussion when you have the meetings with the DBA team. And that's one of the dangers of having them hosting, because they have maintenance job that will go in and enable mirroring on all their databases by default. I've seen that at customers. So it will just give us a much more complex environment, and seriously, keep it simple, okay? There is really no reason for us to do it much more complex than we have to. fault tolerance, if you want to set up fault tolerance, these are the site system roles where you can have multiple instances. I don't want to read them up. The non-fault tolerant role, though, the primary site server. So even though you have SQL on a cluster, hey, your primary site server can go down. So now you just have to worry about your SQL and your primary site server. Why not just focus on one host instead and having them on the same box? Site systems and performance, because we have agreed that we will install SQL locally. Next, we need to protect the primary site server and offload some of the stuff. And the first thing I always do is I offload the user-facing site system roles. Very easy. Distribution point, software update point, application catalog point, and our management point. Away with them, set them up on a separate server. Do I want to do that if we are 800 users in my environment? No. Then I don't care about what TechNet says. I could actually manage 800 users with my laptop there. It has two solid-state drives, 32 gigabytes of memory. And as a matter of fact, a few times it has been used as a distribution point in scenarios where we migrated. And it seems to be working pretty okay. if you are in a medium-sized environment or in an enterprise environment, then I would definitely also look into offloading or creating SQL replicas on my management point. That's a feature that has been around for years. Also supported in CMO7. In 2012, however, it's so much easier actually to set it up. It takes like maybe 10, 15 minutes to set it up, and then it's rock solid. I mean, I usually just set it up and that's about it. Then it will just do its job, and I often don't have any worries about the replica itself. So the question is, how many of you in here are managing a site below 2,000 clients? It's like 10%. Okay. So for you, I would forget the rest of this. No. For you, I would just install everything on the same box. Of course, if you do have a remote site in Wellington or in Sydney or someplace like that, then you might want to have a distribution point. But in your main data center, everything on the same box. That's pretty okay. So that's a very interesting question. So you have your main data center, and then you have some developers overseas.
So they do the packaging, set it up, configure it, and that comes across a VPN once, and then they send it into their primary site and gets pushed out from there.
So it gets pushed out from the primary site, of course.
Primary site within our enterprise environment.
Yeah.
We've got a secondary site where all the developers do their work. So they call locally.
Yeah. Yeah.
From the primary site, it then pushes out to about
120 sites. Yeah, yeah. So you would have to do all the stuff on the primary site. You don't want to set up multiple primary sites. So
No, not multiple primary sites, but would I put my primary, so going, if I'm going to go to 2012 R2, would we put keep the primary site in their domain and the secondary site at the where the developers are working, or would I put my primary site where the developers are working and the secondary site in my primary domain?
Yeah.
Or would I have a distribution point where my primary site, where I wouldn't put a distribution point where my primary developers are?
Nope. So there's a lot. It actually makes pretty good sense. So the thing is, we need to maybe know a little more about your environment. But your developers, they do most of the work. So I take it that you have some packages that are pretty big in size.
Yeah, we want them to be working locally and not bugging everybody else.
Yeah, but the content somehow has to go to Config Manager. So I would let them work locally, but then I would use it could be FTP or something like that to upload the content. But I would still keep the same setup. Maybe I would look into all your, you said you had 100 sites. I would look into there is something called the alternate content providers. I actually have a slide on that. But I would definitely replace my secondary sites with distribution points without knowing anything else about your environment. Yeah, I would do that. Okay, so for those of you who are more than 2, 3, 4, 5,000, I would look into splitting up my site server. So I would have my SQL box, my primary site, and then I would have what I call a user-facing site server. And if we go into the enterprise environment, so how many in here are more than 20,000 users but less than 100? A few of you. Okay, so it's actually the same as the medium site, because I would just add in maybe one or two more user-facing site system roles. But this is where I see more and more companies actually setting up multiple primary sites and adding more and more complexity to the environment, because they say, hey, we are 32,000, and yeah, sure, but we can easily support you with a single primary site. And if you are an enterprise, really enterprise, then of course you have to go with a CAS. And this has been approved, this design by Chuck Norris, so it should be good enough for you as well. I'm going to skip part of this pretty quickly, but we can set up 10 management points. What you don't want to do is you don't want to set up 10 management points in different sites in different locations, because a management point is not a site-aware site system like a distribution point is. So if you set one management point up in your remote location, what will happen is that half of the users from the other location will just go to that management point, and they will be serviced by that management point, and the other half will then go to the data center. So keep your management point in the data center, and if you do have a huge secondary site, set up a secondary site server down there. That way you can set up a management point and control the traffic. But there's really no reason for you to set up multiple. Question?
How many clients per management point?
20. So the question is how many sites, clients per management point. That is 25,000. But there is more to that answer, because 25,000, is that 25,000 asking the management point every second minute? No. That's the default setting. So that's if you have every 60 minutes, then a single management pod will service 25,000. But you don't have 25,000 clients running 24 hours a day, asking the management pod at the exact same hour. You often do not have that. So setting up multiple management pods is often because you want to have some load balancing, perhaps. Again, if you're just 4,000 clients, I wouldn't worry. I would set up a single management point. If I do see any performance issues, then I could always set up another management point later. But in the beginning, I wouldn't really worry about that. So a database replica on your management point, that's something I would set up if we have, like, let's say we are beyond 10,000 users in our environment, and especially if we move into the 30, 40,000 user in the environment, because what happens when a client asks a question is the client will take that question to the management point and say, hey, do you have any policies for me? The management point will say, yeah, I don't know about that. And then it will go ask the SQL server. So if you have 10,000 clients asking that question 24 times a day, you can do the math. That's a lot of calls to your SQL box. And 95% of the time, SQL will say, nope, I don't have any new policies for you. So often it's you're better off setting up a database replica, because then the management point can answer all of those questions. It doesn't have to disturb SQL. And what you have done there is actually you have offloaded the SQL load. any of you running a management point replica today? Nope. So this will be a quick demo. So what I have done is I have already kind of pre-created what I need, because we only have an hour. So these are the stored procedures that I need to run, and I have a complete step-by-step guide that you can download from my blog. It takes like 10-15 minutes, then you have set it up. But you need to run some stored procedures that will actually create the articles that you're going to replicate. Once you have done that, then you will log on to your management point database, and there you will go in and say, I want to subscribe to the replication, and it will just go in and start doing the replication stuff. If you want to use the client notification, you know, the big green button feature where you can push a machine policy instantly to a client, then you also need to exchange the certificates. So that's kind of the last steps I have in there. Again, there is a stored procedure where you go run that, and then it creates the cert. So you create the cert on your management point, import it on your primary, and the other way around. The thing that takes the longest time in real life is actually setting up SQL. And when you set up SQL on your management point, don't have to worry about multiple drives for log files and database files and stuff like that. You will most likely just go in and create a database that is like 3 gigabytes in size, and that will work for you. That's what we have running in production. So that was like a super quick demo of that, but in need to respect the time here. Distribution points. So with the Service Pack 1, we introduced pull distribution points, which are kind of nice. They were then modified and optimized in R2. And in Service Pack 1, we also introduced the cloud-based distribution point. Setting up a cloud-based distribution point can be very useful if you have scenarios where you need to set up a remote office and you don't have the infrastructure. Sometimes, if I have to ship a server to China, or ship a server to Russia or to Eastern Europe, just getting that server into the country can take several months. So in that time, I'm unable to do anything. So what I can do instead is I can set up the cloud-based distribution point. I did that yesterday for the demo here, and I actually timed it, and it took 12 minutes to set it up. Then it needs to do some negotiation and stuff like that, and that took about 15 minutes. But that's all the time it took me to set it up. I will walk you through how. A few things.
So which cloud-based service is supported? Only Azure?
So the question is, what cloud services? Yeah, it's an Azure-based solution. Yeah.
Only Azure.
Only Azure. Yeah, or Azure. Or yeah, yeah. I saw the keynote yesterday. So so it's Azure and Azure. It's the same. Cool. I didn't know that. Some WAN considerations when you have multiple distribution points. I would let me go here and then let's do a quick quiz here. Am I on my box here? I'm on my box here. So if I go into an application, I have the toolkit here, and if I look at my properties and go to my distribution settings, this setting right here, what does this mean? Any good guess? And reading it up loud is not really a guess. See, when I, yeah. That's absolutely correct. So I'm not native English speaking, and when I see text like that, I go like, man, is it just me? Or I really don't understand it. Then I ask some of my friends that are supposed to be English speaking, and they go like, not really sure, and then we have a discussion, but you're absolutely right. So if I go in and take this one here, then you lose control of your WAN connections. Because what you have just said here is that if there is someone in Japan that are requesting an application that you have not sent out there, it will just start downloading the application. So what it will do is it will create something called a DMD file, wake up the distribution manager on the primary site server, and it will start the processing of that application. And I've seen that happen a few times in production where we really needed to take care of our WAN connections. And for whatever reason, we suddenly saw it at three different sites that we had 155 gigabytes of data out there. And we were like, man, how did that happen? So that was actually this setting here. If I take a look at my cloud distribution point, just look at that, my cloud services. So what I have here is a cloud-based distribution point. What I did in order to set it up was I created two certificates. The certificate requirements are exactly the same, and you can actually do with a single cert, but it's for two different purposes. That certificate I upload to Windows Azure. So in Windows Azure, I would log in. And then down in my settings here, I would upload my certificate. That's what I did yesterday. When I then go ahead and create my cloud distribution point, it will ask for the certificate. It will also ask for my subscription ID. So I've already done it once. After I did that, it will go in and ask me a few questions about the location. So if I take a look at my properties in here, you'll see I have some settings, so I set up Northern Europe yesterday. And then I also specified my second certificate. And this is where I say it could, in theory, be the same, but it's more secure to actually have two different certs. Other things I can do in here is I can specify my alerts. It's very important to understand that the alerts will not stop the distribution point from working. So it will just give you an alert. So if you're not aware about that, you will just go ahead and distribute the content. And it will also show you the content. So here you can see I have a line of business applications that I have distributed. And if I go in and take a look at my application there, it is only distributed to the cloud distribution point. So if I go into my client, I should have a client running here. log on as Bob. Oops. You have the application catalog. Perform the install. What I've done here is on my client is absolutely nothing. So after I set up my cloud-based distribution point, I went into DNS, created a CNAME record. It needs to know the address to the cloud-based distribution point, and that's the only thing that my client is actually using. And then the client is using the certificates that are installed on the primary site server. So there are no real client requirements. Question? So the question is, if I have two distribution points, which one will it actually use? It will use the cloud distribution point as a fallback solution. So it will always select your preferred first, and then we'll go in and see, have you configured any allow fallback? So in my scenario here, it was very clear because I didn't have anything. So it would always go ahead and select my cloud-based. Yeah? If it's smart enough to be VPN aware? That's a pretty good question. The answer is maybe. But right now you can see that my software installation is complete. So I do have my modern style VM Monster application. Let me answer your question. I didn't forget it. Maybe it's not really an answer. But if I go in and have a look at my VM Monster application, then in here, see here where we, that's in the deployment type, sorry. Because there is a new feature, it has nothing to do with the cloud distribution point, but there is a new feature in R2 where you can actually trigger a VPN connection. So that's why maybe it's not a cloud-based answer, but you can actually do that. If you want to learn how to do that, attend those two gentlemen's session tomorrow morning because they are going to take you through. And if you didn't plan to, then now you know. No, I can. So we have something in R2 that we call resource company resource access. And in here, I have just happened to have a VPN profile that I have actually deployed. When I have created the VPN profile, then I can actually go in and enable it in my only in my Windows 8 modern style applications as it is right now. So you won't be able to do it in an MSI package or anything like that in R2 preview. Will that be changed? I don't know, but that would be kind of nice. So hopefully that kind of answered your question. Are we back on the slides? So I still have 10 more minutes. No local distribution points. That's kind of back to your question that you had. So what you can do is you can set up what we call an alternate content provider. And I don't know if you've heard about 1E or Adaptiva, but those are the two key players on the market, actually the only players on that market. And what they will is they will actually, all your clients will become distribution points. So that's why I have Despicable Me here in the background, because they will all just work and they will use daisy chaining. So I will start pulling down some content from you. And then once I have the content, I will start sharing it with you and so on and so forth. This means that I can greatly reduce the number of distribution points I have. And there are a lot of success stories from both of them. So I've implemented them in production myself. At one point we were 11,000 users worldwide, more than 130 sites, a single server. I have a buddy in Minneapolis managing 330,000 users, and they are doing that with less than 10 servers. And that's probably more, some of you might have more servers in your environment today, and only like 10% of that user account. So it can definitely be done. There is in R2, there is a change in the branch cache. So when you start deploying R2, if something goes wrong in downloading the branch cache data, it will actually resume it will not start re-downloading the package again. So that's kind of neat. The cloud distribution point, I did show you that. then I will demo that. Software update points, so you can have multiple software update points now if you want to. And my opinion, what I've learned is do it if you need it. If you don't, if you have no, there's nothing wrong today with your WSUS server, don't install a second software update point if you don't need it. If you need it, definitely, it's worth it. But the reason why I'm saying be aware of that is because there is a cost associated with shifting from one software update point to another software update point. When I get installed as a client, I will stick to this software update point, and I will never change, unless the software update point actually doesn't respond to me four times. Then I will go and use the other software update point. But when I do that, I have to re-download a lot of stuff again. So there is a cost, like 4 or 5 megabytes per client. And I've even heard numbers like 70 megabytes per client. I haven't seen that myself. I've just heard that. But now all users are using the second software update point. So if you bring the other one up again, no one is going to use that. So if fault tolerance and load balancing is really important for you, set up network load balancing on your software update points just like you did in CMO7. It's the same, but you set it up in a different way. That's really my key point here. Forest and workgroup support. The reason why I've added this to the slides in here is because with CMO7, it was very easy for us to set up a new primary site. I have a DMC environment, I have a development environment, I could just spin up a primary site, even though there might only be 100 servers out there, and then I could set up a connection between, no trust requirements, no nothing, because I just specified two users. You cannot do that any longer, because now we have SQL replication, and we need Kerberos for that, so it requires a trust relationship. So we have to change the way we're actually managing our DMC environments, or if you have a developer environment and a Q&A environment, because now you need to either, if I just go over here, you need to control everything from the internal primary site server. If you can do that, tell me how you convince security, because I want to learn that. That would be really cool, because that is by far the easiest thing you can do. Open up the required ports. There is a list of ports on TechNet. Test them and then add a few more. Then you're good to go. And you won't have any headaches. You can also set up remote site systems. I have done that. Or we have done that at a single customer. And boy. We are setting up a software update point, a management point, and a distribution point. The thing is, there's really no documentation on what you should do. So it took a while until we realized, okay, the service account has to run as the account we use to install the site server and stuff like that. And then we got it running. But now I have a management point in one environment and a management point in another environment. And remember what I told you about management points. We can't control them. So I have clients in the internal environment trying to get to the management point in the DMC and the other way around, but we have a firewall blocking that. But when you do an OSD image installation, we're searching for a management point. We can't find it, it will stop or it will time out, and then it will ask the other one. So I personally prefer the first solution, controlling everything from a single primary site, if it can be done.
So if you use direct access, so your remote clients are live, but your internal network is IPv4 only, and so in 2012 they no longer support ISOTEL, you will not be able to manage out your VPN clients with direct access.
Your direct, we, for SCCM, so the question is about SCCM and direct access. I mean, if your direct access, now just strictly answering for an SCCM perspective, so if direct access will give you access to your management point, your infrastructure, then we're happy. If it does not because of...
Your clients can connect to your domain. mm-hmm. but your SCCM server can't connect to your clients.
No, but
because it's IPv4 and server 2012 doesn't do ISOTEP.
Yeah, but the thing is, the server never connects to the client. It's always the client that will go to the management point and say, hey, I need this. It will go to the distribution point. It will go to the software update point. We only push stuff out to the client if we do a client push or if we do a client notification, the big green button. But we can live without that. That's not a big issue. I still have a few more minutes. So... one example, if you have a lot of work group machines, there is a, I have a link to the blog post later here. There is a guy in Sweden who did a runbook where he have automated the entire process. And that's available. So if you have Orchestrator, I encourage you to go in and have a look at this runbook. So it will do everything. Copy down the client files, make sure that DNS is working, make sure that the certificate, if that is required, is actually imported, do the install from a local source, do the cleanup after, and you're good to go. So this is the runbook. We don't have much time to go through it. I just have like 2 more minutes. So cross-forest support. I can do this demo here in 30 seconds. So what I would do if I had a second forest here is I would go in and specify my forest. I've already created the forest here that I call sc2012.local. And when I specified the forest, because there is no trust between them, then I went in here and said, I'm going to use this account to create the system management container objects and to do the publishing. Okay, this is normally what our site server account would do in our internal Active Directory. Once I've done that, I would go into publishing and say, please go ahead and publish my management point and my site in the other forest. So it requires that the schema has been extended. And extending the schema is, to me, not a security risk. So I have no issues recommending doing that. It just makes my life easier. After that is done, my discovery methods, my system discovery. If I look at my 2012 discovery in here, sorry, my SC2012 discovery, you will notice that the path is slightly different than a normal path. Because if you just, first of all, because we don't have any trust relationship, we would have a hard time browsing, right? And if you just put in your normal path, then it will actually fail. So this path here, you can actually pick this up by looking in your site component manager log file when it's trying to publish objects. And then you'll say, okay, this is the way we actually have to type in when we are discovering objects from another domain. And when I'm doing that, I'm actually using this discovery, this account again. So I don't have any trust relationship between them. And I'm able now to go ahead and install my clients, discover my clients, and so on and so forth. How I install my clients, it depends. I might use, see here, if I have some clients down here. I might use a, there you go, I have the domain controller. I might use a startup script. So I can just go in and create a group policy object in the other domain, use the startup script. It will query global catalog, but since we have extended the schema, everything is good. with that, and to honor time, so some links, and if you have any more questions, I know the next speaker, he will be on in like 13 minutes, so, but I will be right outside, and if you have any other questions, since he's not in yet, then just bring them on. Otherwise, thank you for attending.